Hello viewers, today we shall discuss about the vulnerable sections in India, legal protection of their human rights. The objectives of this lesson are to understand the meaning of vulnerable sections, to understand the vulnerable sections in India whose human rights need to be protected, to understand the legal regime of human rights in India, and to analyze the various laws relating to protection of human rights in India. First, let us understand the concept of vulnerability and vulnerable sections. We are living in an uneven world. All the members of the society are not similarly situated. Many sections of the society are prone to several human rights violations due to their disadvantageous position. The most common victims of human rights violations are the vulnerable groups, also called marginalized groups. Groups that experience a higher risk of poverty and social exclusion than the general population are called vulnerable groups. Ethnic minorities, migrants, disabled people, the homeless, those struggling with substance abuse, isolated elderly people and children all often face difficulties that can lead to further social exclusion, such as low levels of education and unemployment or underemployment, apart from other kinds of discrimination. Vulnerability refers to the inability to withstand the effects of a hostile environment. It is the result of either human intervention or natural causes. The so-called caste discrimination, religious persecution, atrocities against women and children, negligence of elderly and disabled, and attempts at genocide are few examples of the vulnerability caused by human intervention. On the other hand, natural calamities like earthquakes, floods, famine, cyclones, and other acts of God may be cited as examples of vulnerability caused by nature. The UN Development Program devoted its 2000 Human Development Report to human development and human rights, in which it pointed out that global corporations can have enormous impact on human rights in their employment practices, in their environmental impact, in their support for corrupt regimes, or in their advocacy for policy changes. It is also argued that the globalization is leading to greater problems of state incapacity to comply with human rights obligations. Particularly, economic, social, and cultural rights such as trade union freedoms, the right to work, and the right to social security. It also may have a disproportionate effect on minorities. The inevitable consequence is the violation of basic human rights of the vulnerable sections of the society. India, though, has a great legacy of taking care of the welfare and security of citizens, could not guarantee the same to all sections of the society due to various factors. They include historical, sociological, religious, economic, and political factors. The foreign rulers, including the Britishers and other invaders, had plundered India's economic wealth, destroyed the culture and heritage, and cast a deep dent and division in the society, which contributed to the deterioration of human rights by the 20th century. Thus, when the Britishers left India in 1947, the Indian society was full of unequals and vulnerable sections. Vulnerability in this context can be defined as the diminished capacity of an individual or a group to anticipate, cope with, resist, and recover from the impact of a natural or man-made hazard. The concept is relative and dynamic. Vulnerability is most often associated with poverty, but it can also arise when people are isolated, insecure, and defenseless in the face of risk, shock, or stress. People differ in their exposure to risk as a result of their social group, gender, ethnic or other identity, age, and other factors. It's well known that human rights can be enjoyed without any kind of discrimination towards any individual or group of people. The only condition to be fulfilled to enjoy these rights is that one should be a human being. The human rights shall be made available to all natural persons without any bias on grounds of sex, race, religion, caste, or community and language. However, in view of the denial of these rights to various sections of the society by the time India became independent, it was the primary concern of the statesmen of India to take steps to protect the various human rights of such vulnerable groups. The aim of human rights instruments is the protection of those vulnerable to violations of their fundamental human rights. Often, human rights instruments set out additional guarantees for persons belonging to these groups. The United Nations Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, for example, has repeatedly stressed that the ICESCR, that is the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, is a vehicle for the protection of vulnerable groups within society, requiring the states to extend special protective measures to them and ensure some degree of priority consideration even in the face of severe resource constraints. This lesson focuses on groups that are especially vulnerable to abuse of human rights. Groups that are structurally discriminated against, like women, and groups that have difficulties defending themselves and are therefore in need of special protection. Now, let's have a look at the chronology of events regarding human rights in India, which constitute significant milestones in the evolution of human rights regime in the country. It is pointed out in the previous lessons that the human rights in India trace their origin to the religious scriptures. However, in modern times, particularly during the British regime, certain important developments took place, culminating in the form of fundamental rights under the Constitution of India that came into force on 26 January 1950. A brief look at such chronology of events is as follows. First, abolition of sati. The inhuman practice of sati was formally abolished in the year 1829 by the then Governor General of India, William Bentinck, after years of campaigning by Hindu reform movements such as Brahmo Samaj of Ram Mohan Roy against this orthodox Hindu funeral custom of self-immolation of widows after the death of their husbands. Secondly, for the first time, the fundamental rights were identified and recommended in the year 1928 by Motilal Nehru Committee, which is a precursor to the incorporation of these fundamental rights in the Constitution. Thirdly, the child marriages, which were very frequent and common due to several factors, including social, economic, and religious factors, came to be restrained in the form of a statute called the Child Marriage Restraint Act 1929, popularly known as Sarda Act. This act was the first law for prohibiting marriage of minors under 14 years of age. Next, the enactment and adoption of the Indian Constitution. In 1950, the Constitution of India established a sovereign democratic republic with universal adult franchise. Part 3 of the Constitution contains number of fundamental rights enforceable by the Supreme Court and the High Courts. This remains a very noticeable and significant milestone in the history of human rights in India. Next comes repeal of the Criminal Tribes Act. In 1949, the Draconian Criminal Tribes Act, which was passed in 1871, was repealed. Under this pre-constitutional law, ethnic or social communities in India, which were defined as addicted to the systematic commission of non-bailable offenses, such as thefts, were systematically registered by the government. Since they were described as habitually criminal, restrictions on their movements were also imposed. Adult male members of such groups were forced to report weekly to the local police. Thus, the former criminal tribes were denotified in the year 1952, when the act was replaced with the Habitual Offenders Act of 1952, passed by the Government of India. Next important milestone happens to be the reforms in Hindu personal laws. The passing of the Hindu Women's Right to Property Act in 1937 had given the Hindu widow a share in the property, which led towards the Hindu Code Bill in 1948, drafted by B.N. Rao Committee and was referred to the Select Committee of the Constituent Assembly. The then Law Minister, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, contributed immensely by proposing the reformation and codification of Hindu personal laws. The four major enactments passed in 1955 and 1956 relating to Hindu marriages, succession, adoptions and maintenance, and minority and guardianship are the result of this exercise, which protects the human rights of women and children in their personal matters. Next important milestone is abolition of untouchability. Though the Constitution of India has abolished untouchability under Article 17 of the Constitution, it was felt that there must be a special law to achieve this objective. Accordingly, the Untouchability Offences Act of 1955 was enacted, which was later on renamed as the Protection of Civil Rights Act 1955. This act punishes those who are responsible for enforcing disabilities on certain people born into certain castes. Enactment of Armed Forces Special Powers Act in 1958 is another major development in the context of human rights in India. In 1958, the Parliament of India had passed this act, according to which an area that is proclaimed as disturbed is a protected area, and an officer of the armed forces has enormous powers, extending the power even to open fire or use other kinds of force, even if it causes death against the person who is acting against law or order in the disturbed area for the maintenance of public order. Army officers have legal immunity for their actions. Even though this law can be invoked to protect human rights at large, it has been criticized for its alleged misuse. Prohibition of dowry is one of the important steps in the direction of human rights jurisprudence development in India. When the new Hindu Succession Act 1956 failed to curb the menace of the evil dowry system, the Parliament of India had passed the Dowry Prohibition Act in the year 1961. This law, if properly implemented, is capable of protecting the human rights of women in particular and of the family in general. Another important development is in the form of enactment of the Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act. In the year 1989, the Union of India had enacted this law with a view to prevent the commission of offenses of atrocities against the members of the Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes, to provide for special courts for the trial of such offenses, and for the relief and rehabilitation of the victims of such offenses. National Commission for Minorities, in order to preserve secular traditions and to promote national integration of the Government of India, it attaches the highest importance to the enforcement of the safeguards provided for the minorities, and is of the firm view that effective institutional arrangements are urgently required for the enforcement and implementation of all the safeguards provided for the minorities in the Constitution, in the central and state laws, and in the government policies and administrative schemes enunciated from time to time. With the enactment of the National Commission for Minorities Act in 1992, the Minorities Commission became a statutory body and renamed as National Commission for Minorities. Next comes the establishment of commissions for women. The National Commission for Women Act was enacted in 1990 to constitute a National Commission for Women, and also the constitution of state commissions. The National Commission for Women was set up as statutory body in January 1992 to review the constitutional and legal safeguards for women, and it recommended remedial legislative measures, facilitated redressal of grievances, and advised the government on all policy matters affecting women. Next comes the most important legislation which aims at protection of human rights in India, that is the Protection of Human Rights Act 1993. The Parliament had enacted the act to provide for the constitution of a National Human Rights Commission, state human rights commissions in states, and human rights courts for better protection of human rights. This is the first law enacted in India to protect the human rights guaranteed by the Constitution, recognized by several international instruments and statutes. Next comes the important legislation for the protection of disabled persons. The Persons with Disabilities Equal Opportunities, Protection of Rights and Full Participation Act 1995 had come into enforcement on February 7, 1996. It is a significant step which ensures equal opportunities for the people with disabilities and their full participation in nation building. The Act provides for both the preventive and the promotional aspects of rehabilitation like education, employment and vocational training, reservations, research and manpower development, creation of barrier-free environment, rehabilitation of persons with disability, unemployment allowance for the disabled, special insurance schemes for the disabled employees and establishment of homes for persons with severe disability, etc. Next comes another socio-economic legislation for the benefit of protecting the women from domestic violence, which has become an order of the day. In 2005, the Parliament had enacted a special law called the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act. This act paves way for conferring certain remedial rights of civil nature on the women who are victims of domestic violence. Next comes the law relating to information. It is well known that right to information has been recognized as a universally recognized human right under the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and other international instruments. In the year 2005, India became the 48th country in the world to enact a dedicated legislation for protecting the human right to information under the Right to Information Act 2005, which came into force on 12th October 2005. Next comes the most important effort made to protect the rights of children. The Commissions to Protect Children's Rights came to be established under a central legislation. The National Commission for Protection of Child Rights was established in March 2007 as a statutory body under the Commissions for Protection of Children's Rights Act 2005. It was established to protect, promote and defend child rights in India. This act also envisages constitution of child rights commissions in the states. Aged persons are equally vulnerable to the violation of their human rights. The Indian legislature has enacted a law to protect the human rights of the aged persons and senior citizens. The Maintenance and Welfare of Parents and Senior Citizens Act 2007 is a legislation enacted in 2007, initiated by the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, Government of India. The objective of this legislation include provision of more effective maintenance and welfare of parents and senior citizens, apart from other objectives. This act makes it a legal obligation for the children and legal heirs to provide maintenance to senior citizens and parents by monthly allowance, apart from providing a simple, speedy and inexpensive mechanism for the protection of life and property of elderly persons. The scourge of the modernity is sexual exploitation of the children. The protection of children from sexual offenses has been attracting the attention of many governments, including the Government of India. The Protection of Children from Sexual Offenses Act 2012 was enacted to protect the children in India who are below the age of 18 years and who are most vulnerable to sexual exploitation, and to provide stringent punishments to the perpetrators of such offences. Sexual harassment of the working women has been recognized as an offence, and certain guidelines were laid down by the apex court in the popular case of Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan in the year 1997. To replace those guidelines, the Parliament of India has enacted the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act 2013, and this law seeks to protect women from sexual harassment at their workplace. The above are some of the most important milestones in the sphere of law as part of the onward march of the country in protection of human rights during the last three centuries. It may, however, be noted that the list given above is only illustrative in nature and not exhaustive. The law students can refer to umpteen number of other legislations at the national and state level dealing with the human rights of different sections of the society. Coming to the human rights laws in India at present, it may be seen that there is a plethora of laws being implemented in India at the national and state level to protect human rights of the vulnerable sections of the society. Most of these laws have been either amended from time to time or sometimes repealed to be substituted with new enactments. The Child Marriage Restraint Law has become a law to prohibit child marriages in 2006. Dowry Prohibition Law of 1961 came to be strengthened with the amendments made to the Indian Penal Code. The children are now protected under several laws relating to their right to education, protection from sexual violence and child pornography. The aged persons have a remedy not only under the personal laws and criminal procedure code, but also under a special legislation. The disabled have a special law to protect their human rights. The women in India are quite secure, at least legally, under several legislations. The employment of manual scavengers and construction of dry latrines prohibition act passed in the year 1993 has been enacted to provide for the prohibition of employment of manual scavengers as well as construction or continuance of dry latrines and for the regulation of construction and maintenance of water seal latrines. The various facets of human rights, therefore, are being protected in India through several legislative initiatives, government schemes and enforcement mechanisms. To conclude, we can say that we have made an attempt to discuss the concept of vulnerability, vulnerable sections, the evolution of human rights related laws in India, and the present status of some of those laws on the periphery. We shall discuss the specific laws enacted to protect human rights of several sections like women, children, the aged and the disabled in the coming classes. Viewers, I hope that you have enjoyed this class. We shall meet in the next class. Thank you.